Welcome to the Maintainable Software Podcast, where we explore the art of improving existing software with seasoned practitioners who have helped organizations overcome the problems often associated with technical debt and legacy code. I'm your host, Robbie Russell. On this episode, Andrea Guarino, who is currently a software engineer at Sonar. Andrea joins us from Geneva, Switzerland. Andrea Guarino, we're so glad to have you join us on Maintainable. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm really, really happy to be here as well.
So as you reflect on your experience in the industry, what do you believe are a few common characteristics of, dare I say, well-maintained software?
So to me, the well-maintained software, so the main characteristics is really the ability, so for the code itself, to be easy to change. And more like in general, if we go a bit further, I think that we want the code to be clean. And how do I identify code to be clean is really like so if we take the example of the code being easy to change, that I think it reflects on property that it's like the adaptability of the code. So how adaptable is the code to actually evolve on requirement of the application or so on. Then of course it's not the only component. I think the other components are really so something that I think it's also important is the code to be consistent. So I think it has to adhere to some convention, especially if you have to work with other colleagues in a team, in an organization. And of course, another thing that I think is really important on code is the intentionality. So we want the code to be intentional. And so what I mean here is that, so usually when we write code is to encode some kind of logic so that we want it to be correct. And so we want to make sure that the code is actually correct, that it behaves as we expect to actually behave. And lately, I think also that today, even more, we want the code to be also responsible in a way, because so when we write code, I think it's a kind of a contract we make so between us and the clients of our code, so the user of our software. And so we want the code to be trustworthy. We want to make sure that we don't leak any information from our customer. And I think those are really like important elements to me that characterize code to be well maintained.
One of the things that you mentioned there was consistency in the code. And I think about software developers that are listening to that might be working on projects that were started several years ago and they've joined more recently, for example. And one thing that I've heard from engineers talk about this, and I've experienced it myself, is that when it comes to consistency, it can be difficult when there's stuff that was developed, say, 5-7 years ago with a certain sort of pattern or like an approach that was maybe slightly more popular or at that point in time, but the organization hasn't had a chance to bring that up to, say, current consistent standards. How do you kind of think about going back and revisiting things like that to bring them so they are more consistent with what people are doing today? Or do you think it makes more sense for teams to try to keep things, new things, consistent with how things had been done in the past?
So actually, to me, the actual answer would be it depends, because you know, every case it's really specific. But so let's say that what I also strongly believe is like this methodology that is basically it focuses a lot on the new code. So I think that if the team or the development organization decides to change some pattern in the code, so some way of writing some characteristic or some convention that they want to adopt, I think probably the most pragmatic approach would be, okay, let's make sure that the new code it adheres to this convention or characteristic that we want to have in the code, and then slowly you're gonna anyway touch part of the old code when you have to develop new features. And so I think that will be the occasion then to actually go and rework maybe some part of the old code that was written in the old way, let's say. Then of course if we instead think about really styling, so maybe I don't know, we want to change from tabs to spaces or other things like that, maybe that in that sense it makes sense to just run some automatic to make sure that everything is consistent. So probably it really depends on like case by case. Yeah.
You know, you also mentioned code being responsible and trustworthy. And what are some approaches that you've seen teams take to get to that, to attain that? Like, I trust that this is going to do what we expect it to, especially if, again, back to someone that might be joining an existing project that maybe some of the original developers weren't there and like they don't have enough knowledge of the software code base just yet, but they're learning about it. How do you think about helping those people, or what can those people do to gain more trust, or what can teams do to ensure that the future generations of developers working on a project have some trust in the software that they're working on.
Well, I think this case, I think that there is one role that probably is played by education itself. So we need to make sure that people are well educated also on this subject. So on responsibility and on trustworthiness. And then of course, so we know that as human beings, we can all do mistakes. So, and often they're not intentional. So I think we should also make sure to rely on tools that can help us to identify, I don't know, if for example, there is like a possible leakage of information from the user data. And I think like in this case, really tools that the static analysis, for example, I think are really essential today for developers. And at the same time, I think also having like very, very, very good practices in the organization and the company is also really, really important. And here, what I mean is having in place code reviews, having in place the CI/CD infrastructure. So make sure that you follow, let's say, the best practices that are available in the state of the art of our industry.
That makes a lot of sense. What's your current take on the metaphor technical debt?
Yeah, so the technical debt is something that we all have to deal with, of course, because I think any project that is of a reasonable size, so it's gonna accumulate some technical debt. So it really relates to every software engineer, I think. Then what do I think of it and how to deal with it I would choose like more pragmatic approaches. So I don't believe that the best way to address it directly. So maybe in some case you have to do it, but I think it's probably not the most convenient way to deal with it. So what do I mean here is so let's suppose you identify that you have some existing problems in your application. I don't know, many consistencies is not right. You, I don't know, some code smells, some warnings. And so you might be tempted to say, okay, let's plan a sprint with my team to actually go there and fix all the existing problems or like the 50% of it and go over it. Although I think that this approach is not like super practical and maybe, and why is that? It's because maybe so you're gonna, so every time that you change code, you also risk to introduce some regression. And so if, for example, so if the legacy code is for some existing application that is, so it's already in production since many years, so it's not like a good idea to go there and change everything at once. So it might be a bit risky also for the functionality itself of the application. Also then it might be also a bit, you might have a bit of pushback, I think, by developers, because maybe, I don't know, the people that were writing this software, they already left the company or the team, so it may be difficult to actually understand it and go over it. And often, so this kind of legacy projects are not well tested, and so it's like even difficult to know if we're in breaking something by doing that. So to me, like the more pragmatic approach will be really to really focus on the new code. So first, make sure that the new code is like clean and it actually respects all the standard of quality you have in place. And I think also it would be great to have in place some kind of quality gate that you put in place, so that you know that every time you write new code, you make sure that it's production ready. That it checks all the quality tools that you have in your pipeline, and at the same time, so again, I think that you will have the opportunity to actually touch all the old code because you need it maybe for the new functionality to implement, and in that moment, so it's like the good moment to go there and fix existing problem. So you do it more incrementally, basically. I think that's probably the best way to deal with it.
Hey folks, it's me, Robbie. I want you to take a moment and close your eyes. Now picture your code and your applications as a symphony. Now to keep that symphony playing smoothly, you need an orchestra of tools. That's where our podcast sponsor, AppSignal, takes center stage. They combine the elegance of error tracking, the precision of performance monitoring, and the harmony of logging into one symphonic suite. Whether you're composing with Ruby, jamming with Elixir, orchestrating with Node.js, or harmonizing with Python, or maybe even a little bit of
flourish of JavaScript, AppSignal's got the sheet music for you. And here's the crescendo. Plans start at just $23 US a month. That's got to be music to your budget's ears. Plus, they're certified ISO 27001, and they dance the GDPR and HIPAA compliance beats. So don't miss a beat, my friends. Head on over to appsignal.com and tell them that your good friend Robbie from Maintainable sent you. Now, open your eyes and let the symphony of smooth coding begin. Let's get back to our show.
Is there anything that you've heard, or when you think about technical debt, like as a metaphor that we often use in our industry, do you feel like sometimes it's overused or by people, or maybe misrepresenting like how you would currently think about what is technical debt or what is not technical debt? Do you feel like maybe your understanding or thinking about it has changed over your career?
Yeah, probably it's very subjective in a way, what's technical debt and what's not. And also, I believe it's very difficult to like estimate it precisely, right? Because first we need some kind of measurement that it's more rigorous. You can rely maybe on static analysis. So for example, to make sure, okay, let's count all the bugs that are already existing, all the code smells of your existing code. Although again, I mean, you can have some kind of estimate. But I think it's very difficult then to, so it reminds some kind of subjectivity, I think, in the term itself. And so to me, it really changes a lot on the person you speak with. We try to do our best by estimating with the existing tools, but I think it remains a bit a vague term.
How do you think about when you identify something in your code base, or maybe someone on your team does, and you want to advocate for getting some time to focus on improving that, and it might not be, say, something that's currently in the product backlog or necessarily considered a priority by the product team, you know, kind of air quoting whatever that might be, depending on where people work at. But if there's the business or product people are saying, hey, we need to work on these next 10 new features, but the developers are like, well, there's some kind of stuff over here that's causing some friction or slowing us down. What do you believe are some effective ways for developers to advocate for getting some time budgeted so that they can focus on those things, to they can improve things for the long run versus just tackling what's the next priority and the feature backlog?
Yeah, that's a very, very interesting question. And I think, again, it's something we have to deal with. So all the developers, I think, have this kind of problems. And to me, what I believe is that we should remember, like, what are the principle also of the agile software development. That is, one important principle to me is the continuous refactoring. So I think that we should also keep in mind to allocate some time in every sprint to be able to do some refactoring of the code. So we shouldn't be afraid to do it, because definitely we are the expert, I think, on the software maintenance itself. So I think that we should feel legitimate to say to the product managers or to our stakeholders or to the stakeholders, hey, listen, so we know that we have to deliver this, and to deliver this we also need to do this cleanup work. And and so I think it's also essential to have like a relationship of trust between the developers and the stakeholders. Then of course I know that sometimes it's complicated, so deadlines are coming, so you might be tempted to take some shortcut and put quality behind. Although of course, again, having some tools in place that helps you to make sure that your quality is production ready, I think it's already great. So I think it gives power to developer to say, hey, we cannot ship this to production because we didn't write enough tests. We didn't, so the complexity of this code is too high, so we really need to take time to work on it. Then in some specific case, I think it probably, so if the situation goes a bit out of hand, it's probably fair to say, hey, let's run a sprint on working on reducing the technical debt, or like reworking some part of the application because we hit a wall, I don't know, for two or three times. So I think at that point is like important to acknowledge that, to discuss with the stakeholders again and say, we believe that this is important, even if it doesn't bring the user value immediately. So we strongly believe that it's going to be useful to make the maintainability of the software more sustainable.
Do you have any advice for those listening that might have tried to advocate for working on some improvements in the past, but maybe heard not right now, we'll come back to this a few times, and they stop asking and assuming that it's not a priority for the business? Any advice for those people that might be like, I don't know what to do? I think my answer might be I have to find a new job at some point if I ever want to get to work on this stuff. What can you say to those people right now to maybe make a change where they're currently at?
Yeah, I think that it's complicated often to have this kind of conversation. So to me also, what something that could be useful is really to be more data-driven in a way. So if you manage to show it with some data, that thanks to your reworking, you're gonna save time later. I think it could be already a great tool you have to convince other peoples and your managers. So I think that's something that could be useful. And then of course, so if you use tools, so like Sonar, for example, or like some code quality tools that can help you to show easily how the quality of your software is like impacted by the current decisions, I think it also could be a tool in your hand to actually have this kind of discussions.
Let's take a quick moment to introduce Sonar to our listeners. So what is Sonar and how might it help software development teams?
So Sonar is the company I work with, and yeah, of course, so Sonar is helping the developers to write clean code, and so we offer a solution that it's integrated in the CI/CD pipelines and in the IDE, and so it relies on the static analysis and really helps developers to write code that is clean, so that it's adaptable, it's responsible, intentional, and consistent. So it's the characteristic that we identified as being essential for the code to be defined as clean. And also, so what we strongly believe at Sonar is really the clean as you code methodology. That is something I outlined a bit before as well, so that it's right, this approach on focusing on new code first, because it's where you can have the most impact, and it's something that every team and every company can adapt basically from day zero, because it's like the easiest way to enter into clean code and into code quality. So I think it's more like pragmatic approach, and it really helps you to reduce the technical debt, but more incrementally, so you don't have to plan like some dedicated efforts, but it's more like sustainable and more incremental approach.
How does Sonar kind of integrate into, so you have you mentioned your CI or your IDE, is it something that's running and giving you some sort of report at the end of the process, or is it like, how is it actually integrating it, and what sort of feedback does it provide you?
Yeah, exactly. So integrating in both the CI/CD by providing some reports, and then of course it will also, so we have a web application that will give you a bit more context. So it will give you like a full description of the problem, like with the context of the code itself, and also some best practices to follow and some educational content that you might find there. And of course in this application you have as well a concept of the quality gate, so you can have under control if like your project is in a good state or not to be released at the moment. But yeah, so it integrates also very well in the most popular tools, okay, GitHub, GitLab, and Azure pipeline. And yeah, so it provides you also there some annotation on the code itself, so to make sure that it will identify some, I don't know, some problems, some potential bugs that your application might have. And at the same time, so we also have solution is also includes the IDE support. So in that case, it will be already present in the IDE. So it will tell if there are problems in your code. So it will highlight them like directly when you write code. And we support the most popular IDE as well. So especially in VS Code and IntelliJ and Eclipse, of course, yeah.
We'll be back with our interview with Andrea in just a moment. Hi, it's me, Robbie. I just want to take a quick moment to say thank you. Thank you for listening to the podcast. If you're finding these conversations valuable, please consider sharing a link amongst your peers, your friends, your family, your loved ones, your pets, or maybe you can just write a review on Apple Podcasts to help spread the word. Also, do you know someone that you think would make a great guest on the Maintainable Software Podcast? Shoot me an email to robbie@maintainable.fm and state your case. And now, let's get back to our interview with Andrea Guarino. Nice. I haven't had a chance to play with it yet. Is it work with most programming languages, or are there kind of a subset that you're focusing on at the moment?
So it works with the most popular programming languages. So we have a wide range of those. So we have then the flagship languages that where we provide the most support. And in this case, so it's going to be something. So you might find the one you would expect. So like Java, C++, C#, JavaScript, Python. So in total, we have anyway a support for over 30 programming languages that are supported by the Sonar platform.
Nice. I'll definitely include links to that in the show notes for our listeners so they can take a look at it. And I'm assuming there's a demo or something they can kind of play with or something. Could you tell me a bit more about the clean as you code methodology? You know, there's a book, Clean Code, and tell me more about this. I don't want to make any assumptions that I understand what that means.
So basically the clean as you code methodology, so first it's not really related to the clean code book. So although we share the name, but it's not, I mean, we also share probably some recommendation, but it's really, so we took then a different direction. And then, so the clean as you code is basically this methodology to make sure that the code that you're writing today, the new code is clean. So it respects the criteria of quality and security that you want to have in your code. So what I mean here is also that first it's really, so everything should start also with the definition of what is new code. And like, so new code, you might think of it for example as being a new pull request, for example. So the pull request you're writing to develop a new feature is considered as new code. Although you might also extend a bit the concept to be, okay, maybe also if you work in a sprint, or if you work with the semantic versioning, so it could be the like all the features that you develop in the sprint, or the all the features that are developed between the previous version and the current version that you're developed, so that you basically keep your level of focus where it has to be. And so the clean music code was born also as a need, I think, for people that uses tools for checking code qualities. And at the same time, they have to deal with legacy projects. They don't want to actually receive tons of issues reporting of messages at once. So they have to actually deal with them in a more incremental way. And I think the clean as you code approach is really like a way to put the focus of the developers on the new code. So to make sure that the code that you write today is actually clean. So it's clean code. It's production ready. It's well tested. It has the unit test coverage is good. And so it gives you a tool to deal with reducing the technical that in a more incremental way. And like, for example, also here what I like to mention is there has been also like a way of thinking of software, so of code itself, as a lively organism. And for example, you might wonder how is modified over the years, so how many times code is being rewritten in applications. And for example, so there has been some analysis, some studies that showed how very very often in very very popular projects, so we actually observed this phenomenon of code being rewritten, and only like a small portion of the code it's surviving to the code base from the beginning. So I think that we as developers, we really have this need and this tendency to rewrite, to retouch part of the existing code. So I think that I found this article, maybe I can send you the link later, so that it was very interesting and was showing like I think an average of the selection of projects that were analyzed. I think that only around 30% of the initial commits were actually de-resisted after a few years of maintenance. And I think this also shows how, so if you apply the clean as you code methodology, then you're gonna be able to, okay, today I'm writing these new features, but I have to modify some existing files, some existing function or methods. And so in that moment, so I can also make sure that this file that I have to touch is gonna be clean again. And so I think that in this way, incrementally, so you can really reach a point where most of your code base, then it becomes clean in a more incremental way, so in a more sustainable way.
I like that in thinking around, you know, if you're working on new features, new parts of your development process, and trying to have your team kind of align around this new, what you consider to be a quality approach and some more consistency about how we're gonna start doing things going forward, that makes a lot of sense. How do you think about when you're working on that, and then you do need to touch some older stuff, but maybe you don't fully understand how that older stuff works yet, for people that are kind of trying to navigate that, like, okay, I can do this on this new part, and I have some new parts of the code base that are kind of blank slate, new patterns, but then you do occasionally need to, or probably way more than occasionally need to, adjust something that already was done, but you maybe not understanding. So do you have some strategies for how you go about making sense of that older stuff before you make those changes? Or do you think about that workflow if you start working on the new feature and then trying to figure out what else is this impacting? Should I go back and maybe try to walk me through how you might step through that order of operations there?
So I think maybe the first thing I would do is, okay, I will try maybe to do some modification to this code and see like what are the, so if there are some initial problems on it, like for example, what is the complexity of this method? So does it make sense to rework it maybe? Then of course if it's really something that I don't understand, so maybe okay, the first thing I would do is to speak to the person who wrote it and to look for some kind of documentation. Then of course, often it happens that it's not documented, so we have to deal with it. So it also depends, can I rely on like unit tests, for example, so that I would be more confident. So if I change this part of the code, will the application still work? So I think it's depend a bit on the infrastructure that I have behind me. So I mean, a bit related to this concept, I also think that, so me, I have preference on languages that have a good type system, so that they might also help me to actually let me modify more freely some existing code and make sure that the semantic of what I'm modifying is still there, so it's still like consistent with what I had before. And eventually, yes, I let's say fail on all these prerequisites, so I think I would probably stop and really maybe go back to the whiteboard with my team and make sure that we together we can come up with the working code and that we together understand it, so that maybe we need to go back to specification or to actually better document what we have in place.
I'm curious, are you more often on team refactor or team rewrite?
That's an interesting. So I think I'm more on team rewriting. So because I think the term refactoring is a bit abused, you know, sometimes because so if you're thinking more of the mathematical term refactoring, it really means to make sure that you collect the common part of the of like your application in the case of your software, so that you make sure that you're refactoring, so not redoing the same things multiple times. And I think that sometimes we abuse a bit the term to also mean reworking. So I think that reworking is more what we actually want to do sometimes. But I don't know if it answers your question or you were thinking to something else.
No, I appreciate that. Most people that I have on the podcast will say team refactor, but I do like this, you know, kind of distinction here. Or maybe we're thinking about it's more of like team reworking. It's like you're rethinking something, you're reapproaching it. I suppose that part of my question there is that I will have conversations with developers that just feel like things have gotten to such a state that in their mind, the only way they can get out of it is to like start a brand new application and we're going to do it, I'm air quoting, right this way, this time, because we've learned so much in the past. But I've also seen and you know a lot of stories about how rewrites tend to not be so simple. But I think if maybe on a more of a macro scale of like, here's a whole application, do you think that's better to refactor it? Or do you think it's better to just rewrite it? And my assumption is probably somewhere in between, probably, I would imagine. It depends.
Yeah, exactly. It depends. And okay, yes, I understand better the question. And so when we think that rewriting from scratch would actually help, it might be a bit of a lie we tell ourselves, because often case it's not really the case, because then we're gonna face other challenges. So we have a bit to accept that sometimes, so we have to deal with code that we don't really like, or that we have to deal with some existing situation that are not easy to change. And at the same time, I think it's like important to consistently to make sure that at least what we write today is like in a good shape. So okay, if you frame it like that, so I think I would be more on team refactoring.
You know, I'm also curious around, you know, if you're thinking about when would you be a big advocate for saying, you know what, we're at this certain state in the software project, a rewrite is probably the best decision we have to make.
Okay, so maybe when you would realize that some requirements, they change completely. So for example, if we have to make sure that our application work, I don't know, in some different environments, so in an embedded system, for example, or some memory constraint environment, realize that so the code that we have written so far is not really good for it. So maybe in that case, so it might be worth to actually rewriting from scratch, maybe with the different languages that give you more tools to deal with these new challenges and these new requirements. So maybe that would be a good occasion.
No, I like that kind of distinction there. And I agree. It's like, I'm always curious when people are doing a rewrite. And sometimes I will, you know, I'll have people that I'm talking to in our consulting business, and they'll be like, hey, we're going to rewrite this, but we're going to do it in a new version of something. And then I'm always like, well, are you picking the right tool anymore? Like, should you have a conversation about like, what tools could we choose, rather than being like, this is what everything that our team currently knows? When would you kind of think like, we should maybe reevaluate the landscape of the technology choices that we're making? How would you think through that process?
Yeah, I think probably it really, I would say even in this case, it depends a lot like on when, what are the requirements that you want to fulfill. And yeah, maybe if at some point we realize that having a different technology or a different language could actually help us to better answer to either the new requirements or the existing requirements that were not met before, I think in that moment, probably it would be like the best occasion then to actually change the technology. And so here I'm really thinking also about that probably you shouldn't change a language only based on the hype, right? So I think that probably it's not a good idea. I mean, it could be a good idea for your personal projects, but I think more in a professional environment it's better to not follow too much the hype and be more and rely more on well-established languages, I think, and technologies.
Hey again, it's me, Robbie. I just wanted to take a quick moment to plug my own company, Planet Argon. We're a Ruby on Rails consultancy shop based in the United States, but we've got developers in Europe and in South America. If you have a Ruby on Rails application and you need help upgrading or modernizing your application, get in touch with us at planetargon.com. Also, if you know of a project out there that might be a project you worked on once upon a time that doesn't require multiple full-time software developers, but does need more regular work than kind of a couple hours here and there with freelancer, maybe introduce those projects to us. We like to inherit those types of projects and be the primary development team on those projects for those companies that don't necessarily need to have multiple full-time people working on the project day in and day out, because maybe it's an internal application, does most of what they need to do, but they need more regular maintenance, bug fixing, performance improvements, and upgrades. Again, planetargon.com. Back to the show. That's an interesting thing to kind of think through. I've often talked with teams where they'll find themselves 10, 12 years down the, after they had started the organization and they've got a suite of different projects and different technology platforms and programming languages they're using. And there's this idea of like, well, as you kind of make that distinction there between you should be working on that for the, within the business or versus on a personal project or something, if you want to experiment with something. And I have seen a lot of companies have this kind of problem where developers want to try something for this new project. Oh, we're going to build an API. Like, what's the latest and greatest of that? Maybe it's a different technology choice than what their team was all currently working with, but they want to experiment with that. And they do that, and then people can add it to their resume. And then 2 years later, those people leave, and then no one else had really had an opportunity to work on those projects. And people are like, why did we introduce XYZ into the stack? And we have to find someone that understands that now. What, any advice for people that are kind of thinking through that right now about like, ooh, maybe we should be using this new front end framework for XYZ because it's the new hot thing? Because they also want to feel like if they're not learning new things, that doesn't make them necessarily, they're worried that they're not going to be hireable in the future if they don't have some of these new technology things that they can add onto their CV. So how do you kind of navigate that within a team and then like your personal growth while also having a business need to have wanting to retain your employees and making sure that they have some flexibility to experiment with things, but that can also cause problems down the road?
So in my opinion, the advice I would give is really to step back and think. So maybe that's the first thing to do. And I think that so around the learning new technologies. So also what I strongly believe is that so often it's more important to focus like on the foundational principles, I think. So to really make sure that you invest your education and your knowledge on foundational topics, so that that are relevant to every programming languages and every technology. And so I would encourage more to follow this approach. And then probably you can really bring those in many programming languages. So it's not like a concept that you only can reuse on some specific technologies, I think. And at the same time, yeah, it's true that so the programming must be fun as well. I also like to learn new programming languages, to see new construct, new technologies. So maybe the company could actually dedicate some time so that are dedicated to learning or to have fun, to have hackathon where developers could actually experiment with new technologies and this kind of stuff. So I would follow more this approach. Then actually build some new part of the code that then has to integrate with the old part. Then you have to build some kind of a proxy to make sure that the two technology can work together. And then, yeah, you have more problems to deal with later. So
I'm curious if you can share a little bit at Sonar within your own internal development teams. One, I'm assuming, do you use your own tools on your own projects?
Yes, yeah, we do.
How does your team kind of think about sharing as you're experimenting with new things? Or do you have some tips or tricks for people sitting there? Like, is your team primarily remote or is it kind of hybrid? And how does your team share new ideas and things amongst themselves?
So actually in my team is mainly based in Geneva. So we still have people that work from other offices and remote. Although, so what we actually do, so in my smaller team, so that it's where we actually do all the sprints together. So we have something also called Code Jams. So that it's like a dedicated session where we actually make sure that if there is something new that we introduce in the code or some new pattern or some change that we made, we make sure to share it with the rest of the team. And I found that very, very, very useful and productive to work with. At the same time, so we also have, so in a more larger scale, so we also do some like short demo or short presentation on something that might be relevant to the entire team. And we have also some dedicated space that might be also on topics that are not specific to like the current work, but more like on some new technology that we learn about. And so we have also like some dedicated lunch every 2 weeks where we can actually give presentation to the rest of the company, to the people that are interested.
Out of curiosity, how does your team, like thinking about the logistics of this sort of thing, is there someone that owns, like is someone responsible for organizing the code jams or these lunch and learn type things that you're doing there at Sonar? Or is it something that just kind of materializes somehow because people are like, oh, I'll volunteer to do it. And it's just part of your team culture to raise their hand and say, can I talk at the next lunch thing? Or how does that actually happen?
So actually, it's more like in my team that we introduced. So it's in my team and in another few teams that we started to do that. And it's really part of the team culture, I would say. And it's usually it's people that request a code jam. So for example, if we see that there is like a new feature that has been developed recently, so you can say, hey, I want to do more about this feature. So could you please do some presentation to show us what did you change in the code? What did you have to go through and explain a bit the design?
I like that. So you have a culture of kind of nominating your peers to like, hey, it'd be great if you could talk more about that in an upcoming code jam or something. And I like that. And so if I think if you just think for people listening that sometimes they're trying to figure out how if they want to start doing something like that, they're like, well, who's going to do that? Who's going to organize it? What's the process? Like, how does it actually happen versus being like, let's put a calendar on a date and then this is magically going to, people will show up with some slides or something and walk us through some code.
So basically what we do usually is that, so we have some kind of rituals. So like, so we have a weekly meeting and we actually make sure that we dedicate sometimes to people to ask for to the possibility to have code jams. And then if there is an interest, then we would dedicate a meeting for it. So for the rest of the team.
So I have a couple of quick last questions for you, Andrea. Is there a non-software, non-technical programming, like non-programming book that you find yourself recommending to your peers?
So I would recommend it. So I recently went through a book from Dostoevsky. So it's Brother Karamazov. And I really enjoyed it. So I think that would be my recommendation. So it can be helpful also to change completely, I think, the topic on programming languages and on development and go through it.
Excellent. I'll definitely look that up and include links to that in the show notes for our listeners. And where can listeners best follow your thoughts and ruminations about software development online?
I have a Twitter account. So that could be an option. I have also a website. So it's called andreaguarino.dev. So that's also when I post some link to some existing blog post or something about some talks also that I gave to some conferences. So that could be a place.
Great. I'll definitely include links to all those in the show notes and to Sonar as well for your organization. And with that, it's been such a delight having you join us on Maintainable. Thank you, Andrea, for stopping by to talk shop with us.
Thank you a lot for having me.
Oh.